Hi everyone, and welcome to today's webinar hosted by Mindtree on cutting cloud migration time in half to accelerate benefits. I'm your host, Sarah Jackman. Before we begin the presentation, I have a few housekeeping notes for you. You are currently in listen-only mode. If you experience any technical difficulties during the webinar, click on Help or send us a chat in the webinar console. This is an interactive session, so feel free to type your questions into the question box on your console, and we'll do our best to answer as many as we can at the end of the session. If your question is directed at a specific presenter, please type their name in as well. I'd also like to mention that today's presentation will be recorded and available for future playback. We'll also be conducting a few polls during the webinar and would love your participation. To encourage participation, we'll randomly select two participants to win a wireless charging pad. All poll selections are anonymous, and you may see the results pop up in our future marketing initiatives. And lastly, we'd love to hear from you on social, so feel free to tweet us at Mindtree_LTD or use the hashtag GoCloudWithMindtree. We've got a great program lined up for you today, and to start, I'd like to introduce our experts. From Mindtree, we have Renee Head, Global VP of Cloud and Infrastructure Services. From Microsoft, we have Tim Walton, Cloud Technology Strategist. And our keynote speaker today is joining us from Wolters Kluwer. Jeremy Coles is VP of Architecture and Engineering Services. And now I'd like to turn it over to Renee.
Great, thank you very much. Thanks everyone for joining. You know, about 8 out of 10 of you in the webinar have already started your cloud adoption journey, and some of you may already be fully cloud enabled. Still, the number one question we receive from customers and organizations is, how do I fully leap into cloud? Several business questions that are top of mind, from understanding business needs through how to realize cost efficiencies. And these become more important in the new normal as we're experiencing today. Budgets are incredibly tight. Many organizations can't afford to change anything. Other organizations are well down their cloud journey, but still have not realized some of the expected benefits. So how can you possibly do any of this? In this webinar series, we'll decompose the complex cloud journey into three simple stages: move, live, and unlock. Move is about cloud adoption and building that digital foundation. Live is about cloud operations and governance and hyper-automation of your digital foundation. And the unlock is about exploring new business opportunities and capabilities to mature your cloud capability and monetize that as a service model. Today, we'll zoom in on the first stage, which is about move to cloud, and we'll cover all of the activities from assessing and planning your cloud adoption through establishing your foundation. Move to cloud is focused on your initial cloud adoption. I'll talk a bit about how to accelerate this cloud adoption cycle to cut your cloud adoption cycle time in half. Tim will tell us a little bit more about Microsoft Azure adoption, and Jeremy will discuss a real-world example of the cloud adoption journey at Wolters Kluwer. The very first hurdle that many of you encountered is a plethora of choices and decisions that must be made. Now, let me start with a baseline understanding of several of the potential activities you'll likely encounter for cloud adoption, which I've laid out across the top. Now, you may have a slightly different view in your organization. The intent here is to establish a common reference for this perspective. Right up front, you'll need to address your cloud strategy. Then you'll need to discover at least a basic understanding of your workloads, assess the readiness of your applications and the organization. Once you get through that, you'll be able to define and build your foundational landing zone. By analyzing your inventory workloads, you'll understand how you should treat certain types of workloads. Some workloads you'll rationalize out of cloud altogether. Others will fall into one of several dispositions. You'll want as much as possible categorized into a basic lift and shift, perhaps with some mild optimization. This is your zone of greatest value. This is where we get the biggest cut in our timeline. Once you move these workloads to cloud, you can further mature them at a later date. Remember, the objective here is cloud adoption. You'll certainly encounter some workloads that can take modernization, tech refreshes, database updates, or even a replatform to pass out of the gate. Good value and acceleration still exists in this zone as well. Finally, you may have some complex or legacy workloads that you need to be replaced or recoded. These will clearly take some time. Now, just remember about the simplified approach: move, live, unlock. Consider establishing an adoption glide where everything above the line is part of your adoption, the move, while everything below the line becomes part of your maturity journey, the unlock. The key here is to ensure that your adoption glide still reaps the benefits of cloud adoption. So, a plethora of choices represented on a common baseline. Now let's talk about the acceleration. There's no magic process or code that will instantly cut your migration time in half. We'll have to examine each of these activities to seek acceleration for your cloud adoption. First, we'll take a look at strategy. Cloud strategy, which most of you know, sounds very simple, but does require a lot of cross-organizational involvement on what the future looks like. This can lead to months of formulating your strategy and bogging down your adoption cycle. We figured out how to shorten this stage by as much as 60% with a two-staged approach to establish a charter and roadmap up front and rapidly commission your cloud strategy. The key here is a series of collaborative workshops to formulate and publish an initial charter that focuses on the what of your cloud strategy and less on the how. The cloud adoption framework is also key here, as it contains the collection of the best practices, templates, and trackers that not only accelerate the formulation of your cloud strategy, but can also be used throughout your cloud journey. Next, you can significantly accelerate the discover to roadmap cycle. We'll take several activities all at once and use a platform-led approach. There are several tools available in the marketplace that target each of these activities. Mindtree has our own set of tools here as well. You'll gain velocity and accuracy using a single platform that is designed to cover all of these activities. A platform that can perform an automated discovery of your workloads, map those workloads to infrastructure, identify the dependencies automatically, and help you categorize those workloads into dispositions like I mentioned earlier. This will help you create migration groups or migration waves. There are a few platforms that can also extend into actually moving those defined migration waves directly to the landing zone that you build. Mindtree's cloud migration platform, Compass, is one that can accelerate your discover to roadmap cycle by twice as much. Now I want to jump directly to the move and validate, as hopefully the front end of your cloud adoption roadmap contains a gaggle of lift and shift. So continuing from the previous slide, your dependencies and migration groupings can feed directly into a migration factory. I want to spend just a moment on why a factory model is important. Economy of scale and risk control. Every migration you undertake has a plethora of decisions and preparation, and cloud adoption is no exception. But when it comes to actually moving workloads and data, the process is relatively straightforward. Move from here to there. Interestingly, though, many organizations don't take advantage of the bandwidth of cloud, which is one of the few areas where you can attenuate the risk with technology. To scale your migration, employ a factory model with multiple independent migration lines that are specifically designed to move stuff from here to there. In this model, particularly with a platform-led factory, if one of the migration lines encounters a failure, the other migration lines can still continue, thereby diluting the overall program risk and maintaining forward motion. This type of approach can actually cut your actual migration time in half while also attenuating risks. Now, let's step back a moment and talk about the build to transform cycle that we skipped before. As I mentioned earlier, you can get your foundation built out of the way up front and then add on to your build during your lift and shift. The real difficulty comes in those workloads that are close to the cloud adoption glide, down near the bottom. And anything below the cloud adoption glide can be saved for a maturity initiative later. Here, the real key to accelerating these activities is to take a minimum viable cloud approach. what is the least that you need to complete, both in terms of landing zone as well as operational services. You'll likely get the least amount of acceleration for your cloud adoption from this zone, which is why defining your cloud adoption glide is so important. A product-aligned model provides you also with parallel transformations, but it's not without risk. It's important here to consider a common composable automation platform that all of your product teams utilize. This platform-led and product-aligned agile approach with a shared composable DevOps automation will accelerate your cloud adoption, and you'll see in our upcoming webinars, feeds directly into cloud ops. This also provides you with a foundation for your maturity later. Although you only get about 40 to 45% acceleration out of this zone, the future implications of setting this up right can be enormous. So let's lay it all out on a timeline. The first two sets of activities seem like a lot to do, but they're actually quite small when compared to the duration and the transformation and move, which is where you'll spend the majority of your time in cloud adoption. Using all of the approaches that we discussed, you can see you can cut your cloud migration in half. Recapping the approach, leveraging a comprehensive platform with a minimum viable cloud approach and a migration factory model can cut your migration cost and timeline in half, align better to your business needs, accelerate your time to benefits while also attenuating cloud adoption risks. Nothing in your cloud adoption will be pain-free. Having the ability to recognize real and material cloud migration cost savings is a reality. Okay. So we've talked through the accelerators that can cut your cloud migration in half. Before we get to the next section, I'd like to take a short pause for a quick poll. The poll here is identifying the following element that best represents the top barrier that you may be experiencing. I've categorized them into five different areas. So pick the one that is most likely your top element there. Everything from cost-related, staff availability, complexity, compliance, and even business disruption or risks are included here. So pick one of these as your likely top barrier for cloud adoption. All right, let's take a look at the results. So about 33% of you talk about complexity, and then everything else seems to be dependent there. Okay, so good. I appreciate those answers. I think that's great. Now I'm going to turn it over to Tim Walton from Microsoft for the next section. Tim is Cloud Technology Strategist for Microsoft. Tim, over to you.
Thanks, Renee. Hi, everybody. Yeah, Tim Walton from Microsoft. I actually work in the organization known as One Commercial Partner. That organization actually works with customers and partners to help them build out solutions and their success essentially in the cloud. And so I work with multiple partners such as Mindtree and customers in order to do that. And that's part of our process at Microsoft to help you with this cloud adoption. Stepping back a little bit, I thought I'd talk about a little bit about the cloud and what that means for Microsoft. When you think about the cloud, as was shown on the other slide, we have Office 365, we have Dynamics 365, which are our platform as a service. And then underneath that, we have Power Platform, which is sort of that platform as a service that sort of automates Office 365, Dynamics 365. The thing I'd like to point out is Azure really is the fabric that runs all of those clouds, right? Teams, Office 365 that you use, that Azure runs that. When you think about cloud, and I think this is very key for everybody to understand, when I think of cloud, I think of cloud meaning the optimization of the supply chain of compute, networking, and storage. So not necessarily just Azure, as you think about it, as public cloud, it could mean on-prem. It could actually even essentially mean other clouds that you may be using. Sometimes companies have a multi-cloud approach. So I think it's important to point out that the cloud is about that optimization of supply chain and compute, and that's what Microsoft is essentially doing with our platform. So in order for us to cut down the acquisition costs, the adoption of the cloud, we came up with essentially these four pillars that you see on the screen here. Be future ready, build on your terms, operate hybrid seamlessly, and trust your cloud. I think these are four important pillars that you need to understand, and so we'll drill into those. So the first is be future ready. And on be future ready, what we mean by this is we gotta basically embrace all of the new technologies that's coming up. If we look at things like infrastructure as a service, which most people think about when they think about a cloud, we've gotta give you as many options as you need on VM sizings, et cetera, right? You may need a very large machine, large compute, large storage, et cetera. We need to be able to give customers that option. The other thing that's really important is we got to make sure we give you the bandwidth, to Renee's point, right, to be able to access that cloud and maybe connect it to your on-premises data centers. We've got to give you that. And so we're investing heavily on our global network. And then very key is to make sure we've got enough regions. Here it says 55. It's actually 57. I forgot to update it. Sorry. We're updating this all the time, and that's very important for compliance, data sovereignty, et cetera. So investing in that, we want to make sure that, you know, obviously Microsoft software runs best in our cloud, Azure, right? So we've made significant investments in licensing, et cetera, to address one of the concerns, Renee, that you had on your questionnaire, which was cost, right? Like, how do I make those licensing, maybe for SQL and Windows, so I can use it on-prem and in the cloud? So we've made investments there. And then a very large part of what we do, it says 50% of the Azure VMs run on Linux. It is greater than that, and it's probably into the 70% region right now. We have to embrace open source. If you look at most enterprise customers, for example, 70% of them are gonna embrace open source projects. We've done some very significant work here. A lot of our customers use Red Hat, and so we've actually onboarded their OpenShift product to become sort of first party, and we do co-located support with Red Hat on that. And, you know, we really want to make sure that we meet you where you are. So you can see we've got purpose-built infrastructure such as SAP, VMware, NetApp is now available on Azure, and you can actually get a Cray supercomputer if you want for rental. That would be good. So 1,000 new capabilities. It's important that we push the limits on what you need. You know, and when I think of the next steps, it's going to be quantum computing, AI, and IoT. We just made an acquisition for CyberX in our IoT arena, which is about securing endpoints. So we're always going to continually invest. And I think that's very important for anybody that's adopting the cloud. Next slide. So we've had pretty good success with this, just simply with all of these just new features, whether they're IaaS or platform as a service. Most of the Fortune 500 company has adopted Azure, and it's across all industries, right? So the second pillar that's really important for us to be successful on the cloud adoption framework, if you could go to the next slide, is essentially meeting the customer where they are, right? One of the difficulties that, if I look at the IDG study on what prevents people going to the clouds, is this skill set, right? Sometimes when you go to a cloud, the cloud provider is extremely opinionated on the technologies that you should use. What we want to do at Microsoft is embrace the customer where they're at, right? If they're using open source, if they're using a certain DevOps tool chain, maybe they use Ansible or Vagrant or whatever tools they use, let's allow them to use it and make sure it works really well in our cloud. So that is our commitment. It actually goes back to open source and making sure that we contribute back to open source so that all those tools run really well on Azure. So just a few stats on this slide. Obviously, we acquired GitHub. They run completely separately to us, but we get a lot of feedback from GitHub on what is the new tooling that everybody's using, what's the new language. And based on that, we then invest heavily in Azure to make sure that that works really well. Obviously, we contribute back with such as tools as Visual Studio and Visual Studio Code, which are actually available on GitHub. So let's go to the next slide, the third pillar of making your cloud adoption framework successful. What we're seeing, as the slide indicates, is this increasingly complex environments that our customers have. They have thousands of apps. Sometimes they don't even know they have thousands of apps, but after, Renee, you do an assessment, you sort of discover these apps. And also this diverse infrastructure. Most customers will not be able to go 100% into the cloud, right? I was working with a partner and a customer who did solutions for hospitals. For certain compliance, they cannot move this video conferencing to the cloud. And so there they have to have an edge solution. So we need to embrace that, and we've got to make sure that your cloud adoption framework at least addresses that. So that could be, you know, your on-premises data centers. It could be you may be using hosters, or it could be IoT devices, the edge, branch offices. We need to be able to embrace that. And actually, you know, a lot of our partners and customers have a multi-cloud approach, right? So they're not just using Azure. They could be using AWS. They could be using Google, Alibaba. And so we came up with this solution that we announced last year, which is critically important for you to understand, and that is Azure Arc. Azure Arc will allow you, through your cloud adoption framework, to be able to manage this diverse infrastructure, including multi-cloud, and apply your governance, security, and policy, this governance, risk, and compliance, if you will, across all of those and work together. And that doesn't necessarily mean that we're saying, hey, you know, that everything has to be done on containers. This means servers, containers, everything should be able to be managed from one pane of glass. It's very critically important. And as I see on the IDG study, governance, risk, and compliance is probably one of the biggest showstoppers, followed by cost optimization, believe it or not. If you optimize the supply chain of compute, everybody's going to use it, and you've got to figure out, hey, we need to make sure that we're saving money and we're not just spinning up things that are, you know, that we don't need. So critically important for you to know that. Some of our first party services are beginning to move so you can actually run them anywhere. So I'll give an example, SQL Server. You can now actually run it in AWS and Google Cloud, the actual as a service, and other services that we produce, you'll see being able to be supported both on-prem and in other clouds. So critically important. Next slide. And the final one is, again, goes back to this governance, risk, and compliance, which I think is a pretty big deal for all customers, is that, you know, we've got to make sure that this is a trusted cloud, right? We've got to embrace privacy. Ensure that the data that you put in the cloud, it's your data, not our data. You own it, and also protect that through our security measures. We invest a lot of money, you know, $1 billion a year on security, and we want to make sure that we give you that to you back, right? We want to make sure that we've got enough regions to address your business. I was working with a customer where they absolutely needed multiple regions in Japan, and you know, so therefore these Azure regions are very critical. So we're going to see us expand that and keep going to make sure that you have the data center where you need it. And then obviously when it comes to compliance, we actually have more certifications than any other cloud, and it's something that we're very focused on, right? Ensuring that those compliance settings are good. and then actually giving you what we call Azure blueprints so that you can actually push the compliance policies to your Azure instance, and you'll get a report on what has failed or actually prevent things getting provisioned that is out of compliance. This is a very big focus for us, and so clearly we want to ensure that any research and any development that we do in this area, you'll get the benefit of that. So went over the four things that we believe will help you as you go through this cloud adoption framework and begin to adopt the cloud. But I want you to think it's a holistic approach. We don't want to just focus on public cloud. So next slide, I think actually we're into questions. Audience poll. So my question is, does your organization embrace open source? We are an open source shop. So you're somewhat an open source shop. You rarely embrace open source or not at all? I would really like to know that. I'm very focused with my partners and customers on open source and actually run a V team in Microsoft. Looking at what is the next big projects on open source, you know, what maybe it's Apache, Druid, whatever that may be, and how we can help bring that into Azure. So I'd love to know what how you're embracing open source, and we'll see what that is. Interesting. So we are an open source shop, 18%. You're doing somewhat open source, and I think that's exactly what I see is 51%. 25% is rarely, and some not at all. So that's interesting. Windows 10 actually now has Linux on it. So if you've got Windows 10, you're using open source. Awesome. So I think with that, I'm going to hand over to Jeremy, and Jeremy's going to walk us through his experience through Cloud Adoption Framework.
Yep. So let me pick that up. Thanks, Tim. There's a lot of good stuff there. I particularly appreciated the compliance. I'll have a lot of panel questions for you here later, because security and compliance is important from retail organizations in Florida all the way to wind farms in Hawaii or any other location, right? Different types of security required for each one of those. I would like to introduce our keynote speaker, Jeremy Coles from Wolters Kluwer. Jeremy is the VP of Architecture and Engineering for Wolters Kluwer. Jeremy, over to you.
Thanks. So before we get started, I just want to provide a little bit of information about Wolters Kluwer. So Wolters Kluwer is a global provider of professional information, software solution and services. We support many different industries such as health, tax and accounting, legal and finance professionals. So we have quite a broad spectrum of products that support many different professionals. And, you know, Wolters Kluwer has been around for a while. You may or may not have heard about Wolters Kluwer, but we have over 180 years of domain expertise specifically in supporting various professionals. So we've been a company that's been around for centuries, or a century, a little over a century, almost two. And, you know, we really have embraced the whole journey from a transformation perspective. In fact, we have completed a transformation where many of our products over the past decade have been paper-based products. And today, 89% of our revenue is now based on digital products and services. So that is a substantial transformation for our company over the past decade, which has produced material benefits in terms of how we support and provide services and products to our customers. And, you know, if you think about that, really how that's transformed the company overall is really we're now a technology company. Most of our products are digital. Most of our services are supporting the products. So we really are now a technology company, and that really fundamentally changes how we operate as a company. And that's produced some business problems that we need to focus on. Number one is, how do we enhance customer experience of our products? So now that we've transformed our products to be digital-based, now we're moving up that value chain to say, how do we improve the customer, enhance the customer experience of our products? And we've identified a few constraints that are impeding our ability to do that. Number one is our products have been decentralized over many different data centers. In fact, just 3 years ago, we had over 250 data centers globally. So trying to manage that sprawl of technology supporting our products is obviously challenging as it pertains to speed to market. Number two is technical debt. So, you know, we have and supported all forms and fashions of technology in our portfolio. And obviously, the more you have to support, the harder it is to maintain. And then finally is, you know, a lot of the product teams were really trying to progress their products as it pertains to creating more enhanced, enriched experiences for our customers, but they were limited because they didn't have direct access or limited access to key capabilities of advanced technologies such as artificial intelligence and machine learning. So if you think about these, we really had to look upon how can we expand our domain expertise over 180 years and begin to embrace technology to really support that domain expertise. And we did that and we said, hey, how do we work with our customers to streamline business processes or provide deeper insights via examples of such as artificial intelligence? So a solution was, and the solution that we focused on was how do we get these products closer to these advanced technologies? And that really kicked off about 3 years ago, a data center consolidation initiative where we focused on consolidation. Now, the key here is our executive board challenged us and said, hey, we need to maintain this. We need to do this work within our existing budget. So that means we needed to work with the business, the stakeholders and the businesses specifically to really try to get this planned in their budgets so that they would support it. And one of the key things that we learned was this can't be an IT-centric initiative. It can't be focused on, well, you know, you can use containers or you can use X, Y, and Z. It really had to be a business value proposition that said, if you move to the cloud, you're going to be able to enrich your applications, which in your products, which will give you new revenue growth opportunities, give you opportunities to help us reduce cost overall. And it really had to be pitched that way. In many cases, in almost all the businesses, they've latched onto that and they've supported us in terms of that journey. But it's critical as you're looking to do this in your own companies that you really have to make sure that it's not an IT-centric initiative, but it's a business-centric initiative and how we're going to provide value back to our customers at the end of the day. One of the key guiding principles that worked for our company was we needed to limit transformation as we migrated to the cloud. And I think I saw the poll, you know, one of the highest one there was complexity. So how do you maintain or manage complexity as you're on this journey? And this is one of the key ways that we did that. And if you think about in our situation, having the products spread out over such a distributed area and having things like technical debt, our main focus was how can we get these products as close to the advanced technologies as quickly as possible? And we wanted to do that. And one of the ways we did that was we said, hey, let's not transform as we migrate. Let's mostly lift and shift. Now, we did have certain cases where transformation also made sense as we migrated in terms of supporting cloud native capabilities. But in the majority, we lifted and shifted as is. And then once we were in the cloud, then we focused on the transformation to say, let's move. Let's begin to utilize some of the more enriched capabilities that are available in the cloud. And some of the benefits of that was we were able to accelerate migrations to the products, but we had to do a certain few things that also to address it. Number one, and this ties to the complexity point that was made earlier as well, is you have to make sure that your target state is well architected and engineered. So this, how we had to do this was we focused on service transformation, IT services, and we focused on how do we take these services, the services that we've delivered for years in traditional environments, and how do we enhance these services to be more consumable? And we also wanted to embrace new key concepts such as infrastructure as code, configuration as code, and policy as code. These were essential to trying to maintain the velocity that we were dealing with in the organization, how we wanted to make sure that IT didn't become a bottleneck for the company because, for example, we couldn't provide a core service like bulk mail transfer, as an example, in a timely manner. Our services really had to focus on key critical success factors. And the five that we identified that really govern our service transformation initiative was number one, security. Security doesn't change. It doesn't matter where you are, your compliance and regulatory requirements don't change. So therefore all of your services and all of your products still need to be secure wherever they're hosted, whether that's in the cloud, traditional, does not matter. Security doesn't change. So we had to make sure that our services were secure and complied with our company policy as it pertains to security. Resilience. One of the key things is you know, how are your services resilient? In many cases, your products are going to have a direct dependency on services. So for example, Active Directory or directory services. Is your directory services resilient? What we're focused on is, which is a new use case for us, is multi-cloud. So what happens if, you know, there's a cloud-wide disruption? Does that mean the entire Active Directory service is now become unavailable? Our products can't sustain that type of outage. So we're working now to say some of our services, core services, have to be able to support a multi-cloud presence. And that's where decision-making comes into place of what technologies you use. You know, in many cases, we try to always use cloud-native technologies, but in some cases, especially around multi-cloud, sometimes that's not the case. And so we have to adapt so that we can support that multi-cloud. So the third critical success factor is scalability. We need to make sure that our services can scale at the demand that we have had and are forecasting. Performance is another one. Performance is important. Producing a service that cannot perform to meet the scale is an issue. And then finally, and something we really wanted to make sure we didn't lose sight of, is customer experience. Now, this is customer experience from our business perspective, not customer experience from our customers in the market. This was really making sure that we listened to our customers from an IT perspective. This would be the business, and making sure that services really focused on the key needs that they had. And some of the things that were highlighted as part of that was, number one is we need different ways to consume those services. You know, for example, in many cases, our technology teams that are associated with the products are very cloud knowledgeable and have a lot of cloud experience. So supporting things like CI/CD pipelines and other key capabilities in terms of DevOps was important. They didn't want, for example, to only associate the consumption of services to opening up a ServiceNow request. That would be considered a bottleneck to the organization. So we've had to come up with different use models of how they can consume the services that the GBS or the Global Business Services Organization is responsible for. So from a services perspective, that's why it's really critical that you focus on your target state. The other thing that I want to reinforce that I heard Renee say was how you organize your migration teams is extremely important. So this is something that we learned over time, where we also created factory lines, or we call them squads in our program, where we had squads lined up by division so that those squads didn't have cross dependencies on other resources that could create bottlenecks. If we have a bottleneck in one place, it actually creates a bottleneck for the entire program. That was an extreme value add for the program itself and really helped us unlock and really increase acceleration. So those are some of the key things that we looked at from a solutioning perspective to really help drive and harness that. So where are we in the cloud journey? So after 3 years of going on this journey, we now have less than 100 data centers. And it's our intention to complete the program in the next 2 years. From a Wolters Kluwer perspective, that's provided extreme value add in terms of risk management and risk mitigation, as well as, you know, it's also, as I stated earlier, getting the products and or the applications as close to these advanced technologies as possible. So for example, some of the products that have already received the value out of this would be a product like CCHIQ, which is in our tax and accounting business. They've created a product that looks for critical revenue opportunities that identify clients impacted by tax law changes. And they're using AI-enabled predictive analytics to find these opportunities and present them back to our customers as opportunities for them to be able to pursue potentially additional revenue opportunities. That's real value add to our customers to be able to give them those insights based on our products. The health in our health division, they're focused on utilizing natural language processing to optimize and accelerate manual records review of records. So as an example, our data science team is applying machine learning language and natural language processing to mine through unstructured text that could be in clinician notes, as an example. And a lot of times what you find in these clinician notes is maybe the patient has allergies or some other sort of thing. And what we're trying to focus on is taking that information, extracting it, codifying it, and then mapping it to industry standards so that the people that really need to take care of this, the patients, really have actionable information. They can take action on insights and information that we provide via our products. The final one that I wanted to highlight is in our Global Risk and Compliance Division, Legal View Bill Analyzer Service. So this is an example where we analyze the bills for our corporate and our insurance organizations, where we can, and then the objective is to more efficiently manage their invoices and improve cost management. So we look at the entire invoicing process, which is a business process, and through the combination of advanced technology such as machine learning and also our deep human expertise or domain expertise, we ensure, number one, that we're compliant with the outside regulations as it pertains to billing guidelines, as well as we've been able to identify efficiencies, which has actually reduced our offering clients an average cost savings of 6-9% on legal fees. So we're already realizing the benefits of this, and the company as a whole is focused on an initiative called Expert Solutions, which really is to harness the value out of these advanced technologies that in most cases are available in the cloud. And we couldn't have done this unless we've centralized our applications and pulled them all together into common areas, drive standards, and things of that nature. So that's just a little bit about the Wolters Kluwer journey to the cloud.
Awesome, Jeremy. Great journey there. I'll have a few questions for you. I really appreciated some of those challenges that you mentioned. You actually answered quite a few of my questions. I do want to go into a panel discussion with both Tim and Jeremy here. I've got a few questions of my own, and then I'll open it up to the audience to ask a few questions for as long as time allows. We'll call this a poolside chat, and in the spirit of poolside, we will have a poolside feeling associated with this. I actually have the initial question for both of you. Tim, I'll ask you first. Times have changed here at the moment. We're in a bit of a pandemic still. How did the COVID affect cloud adoption from your perspective?
Great question. It was pretty astonishing, really, how it accelerated the move to cloud, whether it's Azure or Office 365. I think if you look at the stats on Teams usage, for example, we grew in usage that we normally saw that in 2 years happened in 2 months. And that really puts a lot of pressure on systems. And we actually have an article right now on LinkedIn on how the Teams product group sort of dealt with that massive growth. Some really interesting insights, Jeremy, that you should look at on where those bottlenecks were that we had to address. And you're talking about, speed of light issues, right, Jeremy, which is hard to deal with. I guess we could use quantum. But, so it was a massive adoption. It was workloads that weren't necessarily predominant at the time, but like, for example, Windows Virtual Desktop or Citrix became a massive use case, right? And we just saw huge adoption. So to help customers that, Microsoft has certain investments that we can make in customers. So we help them do that migration, and you're talking in some cases, hundreds of thousands of desktops moving to Windows Virtual Desktop and Citrix. So we definitely saw it. We saw it, affect obviously the Teams usage and Office 365. But interestingly, to back to Jeremy's point on governance and risk, when I talk to a lot of enterprise architects, especially in financial services, right, Jeremy and Renee, they're now doing what we call remote engineering, right, where you've got somebody who's working from home and they're doing, whether it's operational code, infrastructure as code, or actually developing, how do you begin to control that quality and governance when everybody's working from home, ensuring they're using the right tools, they're doing it securely. And so that became an actual big challenge for a lot of large enterprise customers, which we help them with. So hopefully that answers your question.
Yeah, fair enough. Now, Jeremy, similar question to you. As you go through your journey, was there a, a COVID impact to what your journey was, or did you accelerate because of it? What was the impact from your perspective?
I think for the good news for Wolters Kluwer is we began to realize the value even more because we had already consolidated quite extensively into the cloud. So, and we had also with our transformational journey from a perspective of services. Again, we were able to just scale up. We weren't trying to figure out what solution to offer. We were just solving a scale issue where we just needed to scale up to support more. So, for example, workspaces. We had already, as a company, had standardized that workspaces would be what we utilize for remote desktops. So, in our situation, we didn't have to figure out how we were going to solve the problem. We just said, we just need to execute. We need to just increase the demand. And the benefits of working in the cloud supported that scalability. I think from a product perspective, I don't think we really missed a beat. Most of the products are in the cloud today, and we continue to operate as we had in the past. I think from a employee perspective, things like the consumption of Teams became even much more important. What I saw was almost all of my meetings now are video based. And, that wasn't something that was, that's not right. Something that changed from, because of COVID-19. It was interesting. I mean, we had video capabilities before COVID-19, but for some reason, the pandemic really drove us to just start to embrace video much more than we had in the past. So the consumption of Teams skyrocketed for Wolters Kluwer. The use of video obviously skyrocketed for Wolters Kluwer. Now that did create some networking challenges because of all of the demand in terms of that, but those were limited by the fact that most of the people were working, if not all people were working from home. So, it didn't become a bottleneck. Now what we have to work on as we progress forward, as those employees start to come back in the office, some cases, we're now working to say, do the offices have the right level of networking in place to support the increased demand of video. So those are some of the things that we've seen that we're trying to address as a company associated with COVID-19.
Yeah, fair enough. Thank you for that. Jeremy, I got another question for you here. So you talked through some key challenges earlier in good detail, actually. A couple of things that caught my ear were the service transformation that you had to go through, and actually being organizations who have already cataloged their services into a more detailed service catalog or service cards may be in better shape on that. But when it comes to the application migrations itself, there was some questions about complexity earlier. How did you determine the prioritization for your application migrations on this journey to cloud at WK?
So when we began 3 years ago, at the end of the day, data center consolidation was about ultimately about risk management. And when you think about it from that perspective, and then obviously it's the opportunity that generates as well. But from a risk management perspective, we said, hey, we're, at the beginning of this journey, we certainly don't want to migrate our most critical applications and products to the cloud. So at the beginning, we said, let's focus on the less critical, more simple applications. Let's learn how to do this in a controlled fashion to begin with. And then over time, what we did is we pivoted and said, okay, now that we've demonstrated we know how to do this and we can manage the products effectively in the cloud, now let's pivot and say, let's go after our more critical applications from a perspective of how do we mitigate the risk, but also increase the velocity of how they can consume advanced technologies. Because if the more critical applications obviously are the ones that generate more revenue. And if we go after those as number two, from a phasing perspective, then that will also give us the best opportunity to increase revenue for those products as well.
Yep, like it. So Tim, just feeding off of that, determining the prioritization, mitigating the risk, and managing that complexity are the key, some of the key cornerstones for cloud adoption. How can Microsoft help with customer and cloud adoption?
Well, obviously, I'm from one commercial partner, right? And you know, the interesting thing is, you know, I'm joined by both of you, is we actually are a partner based company, right? Most of our business, actually, I think it's something like 80% of our business is driven from partners. And so we would look to a Mindtree to obviously help customers do the cloud adoption. You know, and then if you look with Jeremy's products, right, they actually help a lot of our customers, right? That's the Walter's Clue tax products are actually probably one of the top IP co-sells that we deal with. And I always want to point that out. We provide a platform, right, of the supply chain of compute, but really partners such as Mindtree and Walter's Clue, they provide the supply chain of business value, which is something that we don't really do, right? We're sort of a platform company. But we've got a lot of tooling out there that can actually help customers. So if you actually hit the Azure.com site, there is, and you look up cloud adoption framework, there's a really good landing zone there, and it'll walk you through all the different you know, parts of the cloud adoption framework. And it includes some really good tools, right, that allow you to assess where you are, what your maturity is, and you can sort of walk those through, and it'll show you maybe where your gaps are. And then there's some really other good tools for tracking where you are on your journey, right, on that maturity journey. So it'll track you where on your projects. It actually will give you a template that you can implement for Azure DevOps or GitHub, which will give you essentially a discrete set of steps that you can track through Azure DevOps and where you are on that journey. So we've got some really good tools. Most of the details of each of those phases of the cloud adoption framework are based from thousands of different customers going through that adoption framework. And I really do agree with Jeremy actually on his, you know, I always say when you do the cloud adoption framework, I wish I had a t-shirt that said it, nail and scale, right? So to Jeremy's point, I would pick something that's low-hanging fruit and make sure you nail it. So then you get your governance right, your governance compliance for that very simple, perhaps simple workload. There's some good tools out there, you know, like MoveAir and other third-party tools such as that will actually look at your code and do static code analysis, like Unify Cloud. Actually see which applications are going to be difficult to use because of dependencies, et cetera. So there's a lot of tools out there that can help you. What Microsoft will do to help certain customers as they onboard, right, we'll invest in partners such as Mindtree to help them bring you on board and you know, start to, and it may actually even mean something like, you know, we will allow you to stand up your cloud while you test it, so you're not getting dual costs, right? Jeremy, this might happen, right? Where you actually still have it on-prem, but I'm still testing, and like, you know, how do I justify double the costs, Microsoft, right? So there's things that we can help from that perspective. The final thing I will say is we made a significant investment in education, and I think Jeremy brought this up. Skills can be an issue sometime. So we've come up with MS Learn, and it's sort of a gamification, if you will, of getting certified for the cloud. That's become very popular. You know, a lot of our customers has asked, can we waiver some of these certification fees, which we sort of did towards the end of this year, and other advanced specializations. So I think that's very important that we give that. And I think, Jeremy, you actually use another learning tool, I think, which is Pluralsight, which is absolutely fantastic. I think we give a base access to that through MS Learn. But the one thing I love about Pluralsight is it really does embrace that entire platform that you have, right? No matter what DevOps tool that you use, right, Jeremy? No matter, maybe you use Terraform or whatever, you can find some fantastic learning on that. And I think, you know, you'll see more investment from Microsoft to help skill up your people as they move to the cloud.
I think it's really important, and it's something that we've learned is that, you know, these skills are in high demand in the market. So a company like Walter's Clue, what made more sense is to really upskill and reskill employees to really to move towards and to being able to support some of these more enhanced capabilities in the cloud. And that by and far was the right decision for Wolters Kluwer. And as Tim highlighted, we made some good investments in ways that we could really help educate our employees to really be able to improve their own skill sets that as they progress in their careers. And many of the employees, at least for the ones that I have, they've really been supportive of that to really learn and have the opportunity to learn. And that's something I think that has really materialized within Wolters Kluwer. We've really embraced the whole point of certification and really driving towards really focusing on our employees and how we can help them. And then second would be is, utilize your partners. We utilize Mindtree as an example, as a partner for services and for data center migrations. You should use your partners as well to help augment your teams to provide those skills, much needed skills that are necessary to be successful.
Awesome. Good answers both there. I appreciate that discussion. I'm going to take a look at the questions from the audience here. Jeremy, I got a question here from the audience that asks, what performance bottlenecks did you face when you did lift and shift?
So we looked at the biggest thing is in terms of performance is getting the right size. I think if you find yourself in the cloud, there is, there's a size, they can really support any sort of scale that's necessary. Some of the challenges that we did find is more on the, I would say on the edge in terms of cloud native capabilities, maybe it's a WAF or something of that nature, where, sometimes the WAFs are, as an example, might have some performance challenges associated to an application that's maybe moving from a traditional environment where, you might have a checkpoint or something that's much, has a much higher scale and demand. So I would say, you need to watch for those devices that you maybe assume that those won't have a problem, and really look at those and really do unit testing and performance testing to really understand the profiles of those. That mm-hmm. really helped us a lot. But from a VM sizing perspective and what storage types to select, we found in the discovery phase we can very easily identify what the recommended target state should look like from that perspective, and we really had very little challenges as it pertains to getting the compute and or storage at the right performance profile.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and close the poolside chat. Tim, thank you very much for attending. Jeremy, thank you much for taking our keynote today. And thank everybody for attending today's webinar, which is one install of a series of webinars. So stay tuned for some key messages. Sarah, I'll hand it back over to our organizer.
Thanks, Renee. If you're interested in learning more about our cloud solutions, our team is ready to help. So please reach out to us at info@mindtree.com and we'll get right back to you. Again, I'd like to thank our speakers, Renee, Tim, and Jeremy, and a special thanks to you, our audience, for spending the last hour with us. We hope you'll join us for our next two cloud webinars on June 30th and July 28th. Check our Mindtree events webpage and our social channels for more details. And we'd really appreciate it if you take a very short survey immediately following this session. A window will appear when the webinar ends. Thanks again, everyone. Have a great day, and we hope to see you at another event soon. Take care.